Isn't that what recovery is all about?
Yes.
That's awesome. Yes.
Is this on?
Yeah, I think so. Hold on, he's got to give somebody some love real quick. That's what recovery is about. So let's just start off. You want to pray? You want to open us up in prayer? You want me to pray for you? Am I putting you on the spot? I'm sorry.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Father, we just thank you for this testimony here tonight. We know the enemy was defeated by our testimony in the blood of the Lamb, Lord. So we just thank you so much for experience, strength, and hope in Ty's life and as he shares the light of recovery. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right. So why don't you introduce yourself? Not everybody here knows you.
Well, I had to put down some notes here. As you can tell, I'm beyond nervous. You know, my son wrestled in the finals this year at state, and I wasn't even close to this nervous. Not even a bit. So, anybody follow football at all? Yeah. Well, I'm just here so I don't get fined. Seahawks reference, right? That was from the great theologian Marshawn Lynch, all-pro running back for the Seattle Seahawks. Well, like I said, if you can't tell, I'm going to read a little bit here so I don't mess this one up. I'm extremely nervous. I was talking to Six. That's my son, Kasich. I was talking to him before this, and I told him so. And his advice was, relax and be yourself, Dad. Now, when has a 16-year-old kid ever said that? So that's what I'm going to do. So I wish I talked as fast as your wife, man. We'd be done. We'd be done. We'd already be done.
Could you imagine her on meth?
Oh, man. You know? Oh, man. So to break the ice here, I'm going to tell you something. I'm deathly afraid of three things. One being bees. I'm highly allergic, and I run from them every chance, right? Number two is the dentist. I'm not sure why, but I cannot stand them. But I'll get through that. As my last visit cost me several thousand dollars, and we all know why. And three, can anyone guess? Whales.
Oh.
Who said it? Some Uncle Sean. Yeah. Whales.
Why whales? I would think sharks.
Oh, no, not sharks. Sharks didn't spit some guy up where he was supposed to be.
That's good. That's good.
So, lastly, before we get into this, I have to warn you that, I sometimes swear. I don't mean to. Sometimes it just rolls out. I have a mouth like a sailor because, well, one, I was in the Navy. I have a construction dialect. Maybe that's because I spent over two decades working in civil construction. And, I have a truck driver accent, and that's because I have a Class A CDL and I drive truck. All right, well, that's the last of my jokes. I guess we're going to get into this now.
Yeah, we absolutely are. Tell me a little bit about your childhood. How did you grow up?
Well, maybe we go back to the notes, huh? My childhood. Well, one side was good, one side was bad. To start off with, I'm adopted from India. I came over here at, I guess it was roughly about 12 months, 10 months, somewhere around there. It's an educated guess. I was adopted into a fairly good family. I say fairly because that's 50%, right? The family itself was good, but there's some stuff, right? Like all families. So elementary years, kindergarten through up to junior high or so, they were pretty standard, pretty normal, right? I did a lot of sports because, well, if you didn't do sports, you didn't have any friends to hang out with. So the town I came from is Colville. A handful of us in this room are from there. And I can remember only being one of maybe three minorities in that town. So you couple that with, and I was the only minority in my family, my adopted family. You couple that with elementary school kids are mean. They're mean. And when you don't look like them, they let you know. I think it was around second grade or so, I came home, and my adopted mother, Christy, and Dell, they live in Boise. She told me that I colored myself white with chalk. And so this isn't as easy as it looks, is it? That just made me feel like I didn't belong, right? I was already struggling with knowing that I was adopted. I mean, I could look at Dell and go, we don't look alike. We don't talk alike. I'm not built like you, you know? But on the whole side, going to school, you know, that was fine. I did all right. I could have done better, but I never applied myself. The hidden side, the one that really hurts, is I spent from the time that I can remember to the summer before my freshman year going through sexual abuse from an older cousin. And it wrecked me. But I didn't know it. I didn't know it at the time. So when I discovered first alcohol there in, I had to call and ask Christy when all that happened. My mom, I had to ask her. And she said it was around junior high. And man, that was tough. That was a tough year. Junior high is tough anyways. But that's what calmed everything, right? That's what took all the hurt away. That's also, I guess, around sixth grade, fifth grade, was when I was introduced to wrestling. And that's why wrestling is my verse. I don't know if that one's going to pop up here. Is that?
Yeah, you can put that up there.
Yeah. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of the wickedness in the heavenly places. You know, so I wrestled.
So where were you at as far as in anything about God when you were
when I was going through all of that? Yeah, I went to a lot of different youth groups. Went through, you know, the Catholic youth group. Went through a Grace Vineyard. I went to all of them, as I was trying to be friends with as many people as I can. And I would go to, you know, all of these, because I just didn't fit. I didn't fit, and I was so broken inside. And I couldn't talk to anybody. I mean, it took me till I was like 32 to tell my parents what had happened to me all those years. And it was tough. But my folks, they were, you know, Christmas and Easter only type.
Creasters,
CEOs.
Yeah.
we'd go. But I would go to youth groups, and they'd send me to youth groups, and usually they figured that if I was going to youth group, then I wasn't getting in trouble. You and I know that wasn't always the case.
So you didn't have like a personal relationship with God at this point.
You're
just going through the motions.
Just going through the motions.
Looking for acceptance.
I accepted Christ at a sixth grade youth retreat. And I did, and I meant it, but I didn't know what it, you know, I didn't have any follow-up on it. I didn't have any dive into it. It just was something that, you know, these guys were standing in line, and they did it, and okay, that's what we're doing. I'll get pizza, too, you know. That's how it happened. But after that, though, I didn't know, you know, and I'd heard from going to church. I knew who Jesus was because he was within the family, but I still couldn't grasp him because how would Jesus let me come from where I came from or go through what I've been going through? So, like I said, with wrestling, that became my Jesus. Because it's the only place they'd turn you loose and let you hurt someone. And on a side note, my coach is here.
What's up, coach?
Me, so, him and another coach, Uncle Sean, back there. Wow. Some big dogs are here. Wow. And thank you.
So let's fast forward a little bit now. Yeah. into high school.
Into high school. Yeah, so within going through that junior high time, you know, and going through, you know, started smoking pot, trying pills, anything that would alter what my reality was, because my reality was already shifted to begin with. In high school, you know, the thought of suicide was really good. Thought of suicide happened many times. So along my journey, I'm turning 43 here in April, and you know, that has always been something in the back burner, and it's always been my, you know, I thought it was my get out of card free, or did I say that right? Jail card, get out of jail card. I never got a card when I got to jail. They shut the door. Stay there. Stay quiet. Yeah.
Well, you said you were in the service then, so.
Yeah. So after going through high school, you know, that was in and out of trouble. I was in and out of trouble always. Again, the only time I could ever keep my nose clean was when it was wrestling season. I would actually play other sports to serve that suspension, so that I didn't have to miss wrestling. Then, you know, times change, people move on, jobs change, and my group that I had wasn't there anymore. So I got expelled, I got kicked out, I dropped out, got a GED, moved to the coast, partied, which should have been my senior year. So I was 17, the same age as my daughter that's back there, and I was living in some low rundown apartment in Berrien White Center over in Seattle. And you know, the drugs would come and go, the girls would come and go. That's really when this one's embarrassing, but I discovered sex as a way of coping as well. Got myself into a lot of dangerous, risky behavior. Came back home. And I remember, you know, I was at my parents' for a while, right? And they said, you know, you can't be here. And so I thought, well, I'll show them. And I went and signed up in the Navy.
So that's when you ran up to the Navy.
Yeah. Well, it was either I'm going to go there or I'm going to jail.
Right.
That was my two choices.
And then you were in the Navy for 4 years?
Oh, I wish it was 4 years.
Was it?
I got in the Navy and ran even a bigger muck.
Oh, man.
Yeah. I ended up getting stationed in Woodby Island, and that was close enough that I had a car over there, and it took me that first year to realize that I hadn't really created any tangible friendships. I just met people that wanted to go party, other sailors from around the world that just wanted to go party, and I had the wheels to get there. So we would be downtown Seattle, and I would be at Pioneer Square sitting in my truck, or I had a car at the time, and they'd be going in and out of the bars and sneaking me stuff back out, you know, because I wasn't old enough to go. I was just a ride. I was Uber before Uber existed. So that's, well, yeah, so then I ended up getting, oh, I ended up getting trouble, faced dishonorable discharge, and then we went through some processes and some more processes and some more processes after that, and it finally came out that I was bipolar. And so they put me on a different meds. Now, if I back up a little bit, through my high school, getting in a lot of trouble, I had to go to a counselor a lot, too. That counselor locked me up in Sacred Heart, child, adolescent, something or other. That counselor I about knocked out. Coach back there saved me on that one because it turned out that he was a, he was a pedophile, I guess, or... You know, he was on a track team, and he would molest the kids that he was working with, and so that shut me down for trust with counselors. So I just figured I could handle everything else that I could do, you know, and the way that I figured out how to handle it was get drunk, and then whatever else happened after that, whatever else happened to that.
So then I know you're married.
Yeah.
How long have you been married?
Oh shit.
What's your anniversary day? I need to know.
August 13th will be 19 years.
19 years.
Yeah. Dated a year, engaged a year, so 19 plus 2, little help. There we go.
So I imagine so many people that we see in addiction and in and out, trying to look for love, trying to look for acceptance.
Right.
A lot of anger, a lot of fear, all these things start coming up. So what was it like for you when you first walked into a recovery room? When did you say, okay, that's it, I'm done, I've had it?
Final straw? Or
Well, a lot of recovery I know can be like this, right? And I understand that.
I went through a lot
line.
Of rooms. I went through a lot of rooms in high school and afterwards. I think I racked up 10 offenses with stealing and everything else that goes with that.
All the good stuff.
Five MIPs, which are minor in possessions. I don't know what they call them now. And four MICs, which was minor, was basically publicly drunk.
So this last time? Because I'm looking to hear some of the good stuff now.
Yeah.
Because
I get
want
to
some
the good
light.
Stuff.
I want some hope.
Yeah.
What happened?
Well, for the last 20, well, I guess what, I can't remember if I was in counseling when I met my wife 20 years ago. I believe I was. Shortly after that, I went to a rehab, which was like second one. Both court ordered on that. A little bit later, I went through another rehab. So five, ended up going to five. The last one was another DUI. And that was a really big bottom. That was a bottom where I realized that I couldn't do things alone and I needed to reach out. So I called one of my friends that I'd seen that had done stuff before, and he's sitting in here too. That's Vinny. I called him and I said, I don't want to live anymore and I can't do this. And I'm done. But I'm not going to try to do this anymore. I'm done. And he just said, just make it one more day. And I made it one more day, and I came into the rooms of Soul Patrol.
Nice.
And that's where I met a handful of these guys here. And even though I went in there and you know, learned about the Lord and learned about Jesus and remembered, you know, things from my past, I still couldn't get it right. You know, I still couldn't put down the drinking. I actually got sneakier at drinking. I got really good at hiding it. And
you got good at lying?
Oh, I got great at lying. In fact, I couldn't even tell you the truth. If I did nothing that day and only went to McDonald's, I'd still lie to you. You know, I wouldn't even trust myself with an umbrella.
That's what we say. How can you tell an alcoholic's lying?
They were talking.
Yeah, his lips are moving.
His lips
right?
are moving.
So yeah. Then you went into Soul Patrol. You start learning about the Lord.
Yeah.
At what point did, like, the Bible start coming to life? What point did the recovery life start, like, this is the way, this is freedom? When did that happen for you? What was the switch?
I think I got that one here, because I don't want to mess it up.
Those are the best moments we all remember, right?
Yeah. That would have been March 10th of 2023. I reached my limit on lies. Again, I wrote that down. If I was talking, I was lying. You know, I had to be honest with myself. And there was a guy that was texting me and was staying in close quarters with me, and always asking about the kids. And that's Coach Vaughn. I don't know if you guys know who he is, but he's amazing. And I wrote to him. I wrote to him. I said, Coach Vaughn, well, Coach, I'm, and I actually went back and grabbed this from our text. I said, I'm not trying to appear that I have it together at the least, but I have to fully rely on God. I'm not trying to say the right thing because I'm an absolute mess right now. I know I can't do this alone. I've tried. I'm scared more than I've ever been, and I feel so alone. And I hear my voice telling me to end it, but I can't do that again. I've tried. So I moved forward. I just moved to the next task, fighting these painful memories that are hammering. They're relentlessly coming out of me. I literally have to constantly shake these thoughts. I'm in a battle. The struggle is not one I wished on anyone. My only encouragement is that it's one bite at a time. A couple years prior to this, I led my daughter to Christ on our way to school. And I didn't know if any of that ever caught. But on that march, the night before I had sent that text to Dave, you know, I was, you know, engaged in Jesus. I could feel him moving in me. I wasn't drinking all the time. I literally had drank 3, 4, 5, 6 times from 2020 to that day. And that night before, I had gone out and I'd had my kids with me. And, you know, they're old enough to drive, so I let them drive, and I justified all of that stuff, right? They were driving, I wasn't driving, I could drink. And I guess in some normal families that would be okay, I guess, but it wasn't in mine. And I drank a lot more than anybody thought. And my wife said, don't come home. And so I said, okay. And she came in, and she picked up 6, and they went home. I don't know where he was at, but he was with some other wrestlers. And I stayed the night at another friend's house, a good friend, mind you, but I stayed the night there, and I came home that next morning, and that's when I sent that text to Coach, and I just prayed, and I was sitting on the, he opened the door to our bedroom, and I was sitting on the door, on the floor, and I prayed, you know, God, just, you're going to have to do this. You're going to have to show me. You're going to have to show up. And the reason I say about my daughter leading her to Christ is she comes in and she starts talking to me. And then we started crying. And she just started crying. And she told me that, you know, my wife, Tracy, the mom was laying on the floor crying there last night. And as I was crying, I was thinking, you know, I can't leave because I love this girl so much. And I felt that peace. And it wasn't audible. It wasn't a voice. But it was like, I love you more than that. How you're feeling, I love you more. And so, you know, I just kept pressing in and pressing in throughout the days. We had an in-house separation that was really, really weird. I was in the downstairs bedroom, and everything was transactional between my wife and I. And I noticed during that whole time she wasn't wearing her wedding ring anymore, and I knew it was over. And we have an open phone policy in our house, too, so I looked at a couple texts that she talked to another friend and said, yep, it's over, and he's moving out, and I just prayed again, and I prayed again, and I said, go get your Bible, right, and I couldn't find mine, because I don't know where it was, but I found hers, because it was sitting next to her chair, and so I open it up, and it goes to James 5:20, And I knew, and that, if you're looking for that come alive moment, Matt.
Yeah.
That is it. because I know that she'd been praying for me for over 2 decades and refused to let up. And I'm telling you guys, I've done everything under the sun there is to do. I've done everything under the sun there is to do. I've been there. I've been lost. I've been in the wrong arms. I've been there. Every piece. And there is not one thread of worldly acceptance that would say that she would stay with me and be through this if there wasn't a God. If there wasn't Jesus, there's no way.
Amen. That's so good, Ty. I love to hear that. So you got, when do you have your year now?
I have my year on March 1st.
March 1st. I know so many of us can relate to your story. So many of us have been there. So many of us have lived the life of a lie. Yeah. And for your wife to be there believing and praying, your daughter to be there believing and praying, goes to show you the power of prayer. It goes to show you the power of that verse right there, Ty. The fact that you're up here right now sharing your story in front of this many people and that you have a year of sobriety goes to show me that God is still doing miracles. Amen?
Amen.
Well, we're going to watch some people get some coins tonight, and we're going to, Ty has this as we come down, Ty has a video that we're going to show, Brandon Lake.
Yeah.
What does this song mean to you before they watch it?
It means that you can never count yourself out. Like he can do anything. He can do anything.
Amen.
Anything.
Amen. Amen. Give it up for Ty.
Give it up for Ty and Matthew Cottom. Wow, welcome Northbridge family. This is crazy cool to see so many people here. Give it up for Ty's wife, Tracy. Oh, I just want to share, I think I met Ty a year ago, March, whatever, Thursday, and he walked in here with Mick Dolan, yeah? And the pain in his eyes. Ugh. The pain in his eyes when he came in here. Stop it, Sarah. Shut up. Shut up. I don't cry. Okay. I'm a gangster. Wow. The pain in his eyes when he walked in here. And I didn't even know him. And I didn't even know his story. And I didn't need to. But I looked at him and I said, you're home. And you're coming back. And then he brought his wife to the next coin night. Oh my gosh, and look at what God does. He restores our marriages. She has been through hell and back, and I know, because who has not been through praying and crying? over somebody. My brother's out there, you guys, right now, y'all. He is just wasted, and he's so far gone. Pray for him. Who's praying for somebody out here to get sober, you guys? I'm wearing a shirt right now that says, Hope Dealer. Hope Dealer, because we're dealing in hope right now. Ty, you are full of hope. You changed somebody's life tonight. Seriously, how powerful, you guys. Sarah said it too. We are the light. You have no idea, Johnny says, how far your light shines. I can look right over here and oh my gosh, turn the lights down. It is crazy bright over here. I want you ladies to know how powerful and how full of light you are, and I just want to thank you for being here. Wow, and Northbridge Recovery, I'm sorry, this is crazy cool. This is so powerful. Are you crying? Okay, he's crying too. Y'all, we cry around here, and crying means feelings, and we're learning how to feel things, and we're learning about emotions and vulnerability, and it is beautiful because God wrecks us so that we are so dependent on him, because we're like, I've tried everything. I've tried it my way. I've tried the bottle. I've tried this. I've tried that, and I can't, God. And Ty said it, and he said, you're going to have to do this, God, because I can't. And he's doing it. Look at that, and you're never going back. I don't even know where he's at, but I'm looking over here. There he is. Okay. All right. Give it up one more time for Ty's testimony. That was so beautiful. I do want to share with you all, the bathrooms are outside. If you have to go, they're outside in a little trailer. I love the bathroom, and nobody shared that with anybody, so I wanted to share that. Welcome to Coin Night and Testimony Night. What we do here tonight, women are going to go first. So if you are celebrating any sort of clean time, we're going to call it out by one day, 24 hours. If right now is the last time you're out in the car, just got loaded before you came in, and today is the day you want to give it to God and change your life, we'll call you up. 24 hours, 30 days sober, 60, 90, and so on and so forth. So if you are celebrating any clean time and you're a female, when I call that out, come on up. This is my friend,
Christy.
Her name's Christy. Give it up for Christy. Okay, let's get into it, y'all. 24 hours. Today is day one of the rest of your life. Anyone want to come up and get a coin? 30 days sober, ladies. Anybody celebrating 30 days? Also, I want to mention, after you come up and get your coin, we're going to stand right here and we're going to say, Sabrina, wave your hand, Sabrina. We want to celebrate with you, and we want to share it to the world that you're celebrating your clean time. So if you don't mind and you're not camera shy, stand right over there. 60 days, ladies. Woo! The next one, 9 months. Anybody celebrating 9 months clean and sober? Dang. Yeah. Yeah, do it, Joel. 1 year clean and sober! Woo! 1 year, and then 18 months. Ladies, anybody celebrating? Are you kidding me? Woo-hoo! I'm so glad to see you. So glad to see you. Oh, pregnant, IV meth user, just homeless, living out of my car, codependent, this train wreck. Look at it. That is her daughter and her baby. Like, lives changed. Babies and families, lives changed. Did you do it by yourself? Nobody helped you get where you're at? No, it was from Jesus, and it was from love and support of people who shine from the love of Jesus. God is so good. All the time. Two? 2 years, lady. Who's celebrating? Even happen 4 years clean and sober. Where's Bree Dolan? Husband, I think, had a hand in a little bit of it. Oh. Give it up for Bree, 4 years. Woo! So good. I love what Ty said. It hits you deep. Like, we all are trying to numb something, right? Bree struggled with some grief. What Ty struggled with, many of us struggle with here in this room. God is so good. 5 years, ladies. Anybody celebrating 5 years clean and sober? 6 years clean and sober? Seven? Eight?
Nine?
Go, Christy. Woo! Give it up for Christy! 10 years. Anybody celebrating a decade sober? 11? Amen. so good. 12 years. 13. 14, 15, 16. What? Got her. 13 years. Whoa. How many years ago? 13 years ago. That's crazy. How many people do we know from back in the day? So cool. God is so good. 13 years sober. Congratulations. 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. I think we're going to hand it over to the men tonight. Give it up for all the ladies. Josh Huff and Matt Moulton, they're going to cry, and they're going to make you cry.
Awesome. Give it up for those ladies. Is that cool or what? You know what impacted me the most about tonight, about Ty's message, was how his wife was praying for him, I'm sure, every single day, right? I can remember that's how I met Jesus. I had my stepmom praying for me. Her sister, who was dying of cancer, got all these churches down in the wheat country, all down south, praying for me that I would get to know Jesus. And all this weird stuff started happening. In fact, I was kind of mad that she was praying for me, because I didn't want the weird stuff to happen, and I knew that God was trying to reach me, right? So, you don't have to be embarrassed, but how many of you guys who have sobriety today had somebody praying for you? Raise your hand. Look at all of those prayers out there. You know what that is? That's a promise from God's Word that says that when you pray, God hears your prayer. Is that cool? We're all products of God's promise. Is that awesome? How many of you guys seen the rainbow tonight on the way to church? Was that cool? There was a double rainbow coming up the Bigelow. And where it landed, it looked like it was just feet away. It's the closest I've ever been to the end of a rainbow on the way here tonight. And it reminded me of the promise that God wasn't going to destroy the earth anymore by a flood. Is that cool? Every time I get a coin, I carry that coin in my pocket for as long as I can. And every time I reach in there, I feel the coin in there. And I know that I think about that as God's rainbow, as a symbol of God's promise. That he answered my stepmom's prayer, who eventually led me to Jesus. Is that awesome? So if you guys get a coin tonight, I want you to carry that coin with you wherever you go and wear that thing loud and proud. And just know that every time you touch that coin in your pocket, or every time you pick it up, or every time you see it, it's a promise from God. That is your rainbow. Carry that everywhere you go. Amen? Awesome. If you guys don't know, this is my lifelong buddy, Matt Moulton. Matt brought me to church the very first time. How old were we when we went to Super Church? Like 7 or 8? That was probably like 40 years ago. It wasn't too far from here, actually. And it was on Easter Sunday. And Pastor Paul? One of the pastors there said that if we had so many visitors, he'd swallow a live goldfish. It was kind of gross. But he actually did. He swallowed a live goldfish. And then we went outside for an Easter egg hunt. I'll never forget that. They were the worst candy Easter eggs I've ever eaten in my life. I found them in the couch like 2 years later, and they were still edible. Anyways, Matt is a product of prayer. Is that cool? He brought me to church my first time, and now he's here after much, much prayer.
I'm here because of Josh Huff. All that praying that he did for me, he brought me into the doors here at Northbridge, and it's all of you guys here that have kept me coming back, and Jesus, of course.
He's here because God's word promises that he hears our prayer. Amen. So if you guys have somebody out there on the streets, a family member, a loved one, a friend, a relative, a brother, sister, even your next door neighbor, start praying for them, because one day we're going to have to build another sanctuary. Is that awesome? Awesome. So if you're a guy and you got one day of sobriety, or you want today to be your first day, come on up and get a coin. Oh, yeah. Today's your day. That's awesome. He's a product of our prayers. We've been praying for him for a long time. Is that cool? All right, if you're a guy and you got 30 days, come on up and get a coin. No? How about 60 days? There he is. Come on up here. Yeah. Coming up both sides. Steven. There's Steven's parents, man. You know what's awesome? My favorite part about being up here is getting to watch the smiles on your family members' faces when their sons or daughters come up to get a coin. You got 90 days. Come on up and get a coin for the guys. All right. 6 months. Glad Matt's on it. I can't even think right now. 9 months. No nine? All right. Now we're moving on to the brass. So if you get a brass coin tonight and it's 1 year or 18 months, we have been having so much sobriety lately that they can't print the coins out fast enough, right? So we'll give you one of these 12-step coins, but you need to go see Katie. And then you need to come back here next month and get and we'll give you a 1 year coin, all right? Because we're out. Is that awesome? It's not awesome we're out, but it's just awesome that we've given out so many that they can't keep up with us. All right, so did Ty have a year? Come on up, Ty. Got one on the phone. He's at work, can't make it. Yeah, good job. There it is. Sweet. All right, anybody else have a year for the guys? How about 18 months? No 18 months? How about 2 years? How about 3 years for the guys? About four. There we go. What do we got? 4 years. Nick Dolan. That's Mickey Dolan right there. That's Bree's husband. Yeah. Oh, man, that's so awesome. I've watched Mickey in the rooms of recovery for a long time, and we used to go snowboarding together right when we all first started, you know, getting sober. Remember that? Oh, man, we'd all get to the bottom of the lift, and Sarah's like, come ride with me. I was like, no, I'm going to hang out down here. I'm looking for a single. She's like, what are you talking about? See that guy over there? Yeah, I'm going to ride with him. I'm going to tell him about Jesus all the way to the top of the lift. But Mickey would go with us, and it's pretty awesome. Well, Mickey didn't make it as long as the rest of us did. And I remember Casey would always call me up and say, man, you got to pray for Mick, man. One day Mick called me and said, dude, I got this bandsaw, man. Come over. It's at my grandma's house. And I needed a bandsaw to cut up my deer in the winter. I go over there, and he looked like he was doing okay, and I handed him $50. I said, don't buy anything like that. Well, I wouldn't with this. Oh, I won't. Yeah, right. I'm sure he did. Anyways, a couple years later, Casey calls me and says, Mick's in the county jail, man. You need to go talk to him. And so I went out to Geiger, and there was Mickey, and I had the eight control call him over, and Mickey comes over. He thought he was going to court or getting released. He was all bummed out when he seen me. He's like, oh, Josh, what are you doing here? And I said, dude, I've been praying for this day for a long time. Is that awesome? And I've been praying that Mickey would actually wind up in there, and so that I could talk to him and tell him the good news. And he never forgot about that, did you, Mick? Well, here he is, a product of prayer. Is that cool? Celebrating sobriety. Awesome. Where are we at, Matt? 5 years. How about 6 years? 7 years for the guys. How about 8 years? Come on, 9, 10. You can't let the girls beat us. 11, 12, 13. 13 years. Michael Moore. Oh, Michael Moore. This guy, I swear, follows us around everywhere we go. If there's a church door open, there's Michael Moore. He's everywhere. That guy is a faithful believer in Jesus. Amen. Awesome. How about 14 years for the guys? There we go. I knew we were going to beat the ladies. Oh, he got it. 14 years. Awesome. 14 years. That's a good stretch right there. One day at a time, amen. How about 15 years? 16, 17, 18. Any guys above 18? All right. Give them all a hand one more time.